Yeah, my
ladies and gentlemen, let's start the second panel. There was lots of food for thought from the first panel that we can also talk about here in the second panel. We want to talk about a crisis here of the rebel order and would like to turn the focus on anti-democratic elements in this development. The situation of anti-liberal forces varies by country in Europe. In countries, if an anti-liberal power gets the majority and has the government in a country, then we see that, and we see that the concern is justified if the majority changes a system such that it runs the risk of becoming an authoritarian regime, and that politics has supremacy over justice. Now, how can we explain these anti-liberal, anti-democratic momentum? What are our answers, and how can, and that is the subject matter of this panel, how can Europe defend its values? We have illustrious guests to discuss that. We have Ulrich Preuß, he's Professor Emeritus for Public Law at the Hertie School of Governments. And in Bremen, he's also a judge. Was a judge, sorry, excuse me. I would like to welcome Barbara Nowacka. Warm welcome. She is Polish feminist and politician. She's the chairperson of Teuruch political party. And recently she hit the headlines when she was a part of that against that amendment of the PiS or the PiS law driven or PiS party driven amendment of the abortion law, and she is now so famous that the Brigitte in Germany made a feature of it, and she is top global thinkers in the year 2016 by a political magazine here. To my left, we have Annalena Baerbock. Warm welcome. She is a member of the German federal parliament. She is a spokesperson for climate policy, and among other things, she is a speaker of the European Committee and the Parliamentary Assembly of the European Council. And to my very left, we have Alexander Freiherr Knigge. Warm welcome. He is a lawyer in Berlin, and he is a co-initiator of the initiative Pulse of Europe, which he is going to introduce to us here today. Mr. Preuß, I would like to start with you, and I would like to ask you the following. What anti-democratic, anti-liberal challenges are we confronted with? And how can you explain that they have gained so much momentum in recent years? Well, this is a wide field. Permit me to make an upfront comment on what Andrew Muravchik was saying earlier. We are referring all of this year to Europe. We should shy away from stricter benchmarks regarding crisis resolution of Europe compared with national states, which have a different coherence, which a alliance of states cannot have, like the European Union. Just imagine the U.S. in a majority in the parliament refutes a proposal of the president for the nomination of a new judge If we had that in Europe, it would have been a constitutional crisis. But this is, I wouldn't call that liberal democracy, but constitutional democracy rather. And but I don't want to praise Europe here, but I would like to rather answer your question. These challenges through right-wing populist movements are an issue, are a problem. But not just of Europe. It is a worldwide problem. In other words, the root causes for the populist movement momentum cannot be found in the question, how does Europe work or not work? I think this tenet is wrong. I thought Mr. Morasic was saying similar things. There are countries which have nothing to do with Europe, which have similar developments. There is a poll, and among 32,000 people in 28 countries, of which not all belong to Europe. 72% in France said the system is not working anymore. They meant their own democracy. They didn't mean Europe. And 62% said in Germany, and 57% in the United Kingdom and the United States. And when you probed, what's your explanation for that? What's the problem? And 83% then said they are concerned about the erosion here. I read that from an English text here. Erosion of social values, and they were saying the values that made our country great are diminishing. 69% voice concern about globalization. 76% believed that migration is a major problem. And 68% quoted that the speed of innovation and change is too fast and doesn't bring good things for the country, their country, their respective country. Well, meaning that this formula, taking back control, we want our country back, or making America great again, that this notion here, and if the feeling is that the people have lost control over their lives, and that is worldwide, it's not just in Europe or in the US. And that does mean that there's appeal to the politicians, but you cannot give an answer to this claim here, because the digital revolution, with this enormous consequence for the world of labor, is something that the politicians cannot. This development is something that the politicians cannot interfere with. To close the borders, regain the nation state of the 19th century, open society and open statehood. These are the two critical points that that these peoples in the poll view to be a threat to them. And does. And this and angst is the driving force for the feeling that the system isn't working anymore. And theoreticians of democracy in the 1930s already talked about that. So how does democracy deal with angst and anxiety? And that is an elementary feeling. You have no way of tackling with this, because part of the answers lie not in the realm of politicians. So what is a possible answer? Uh, I think we should go in the offensive, and we should say that those who assert that they have an answer, closed borders, our nation first, that brings us back to that closed statehood of the middle of the 19th century. That is hypocrisy, that this would solve the problem. It will not solve the problem. Solutions like strong man like Putin, Erdogan, what have you. Of course, that is no solution. We know that, but you have to communicate that, like indicators, extent of corruption in these countries, extent of economic stagnation in these countries, the extent of environmental degradation, of destroying individual existence, creating angst, suppression. And these are all indicators. And I would like to use a term which may sound strange, but one should compare these systems. You must say, look at Europe. We don't have these problems. We don't have that extent of corruption. We don't have that amount of environmental degradation. And the EU has this map of bliss. That sounds a bit funny, you know, but it's social science indicators about happiness. And the peak states are all in Europe. Norway, Denmark, Germany scoring 16s. In other words, one should compare these systems. Compare our system with China, with Russia, Putin, with his authoritarianism, which is only working on the basis of corruption. Quality of life in Europe is a factor which has to be, you know, advertised for. We have to communicate that this is such. Of course, there's accelerated digitization. There is changes in social cohesion. And all these things, politicians can only give limited answer to these problems. That's a fact of life. You have to live with it. And it is no good of pretending as though politicians could give you a solution. No, it's not such. There are certain developments which cannot be managed by way of policies and by politicians. The world is changing, and that's a fact. And international cooperation is the only solution, and that is something that you have to be clear of and have to communicate. Thank you. Now, the two politicians on the panel, I would like to ask you, Mr. Preuß speaks of the limits of politics, the limitations of politics. But at the same time, he says, nowhere else in the world are people more satisfied than in Europe. But they still turn to system, to political trends which are alien to our their system. Why do they do that? Annalena, has liberal politics failed, like Jan Cilonka said, because it admitted too much inequality? Or what's the reason? Well, there is no monocausal explanation, like with many other things in life. There's various different levels here. Look at these various different countries. You cannot just say, oh, across Europe we have such. No, it's differing by countries. And what do we learn from Brexit? You can learn a lot from, but you can learn a lot, but Poland will work differently from, like, Great Britain. But you may become a politician, or you will become a politician, because you don't want to paint everything black. And have we failed? Are the anti-liberal forces in the majority? And if you look at the statistics, then statistics clearly say no. We are not the active minority. Because if you look across Europe, the basic values of the European Union and Europe such, the approval rate is 80% and more. Of course, in some European countries, you have forces which are elected, which are anti-liberal. And then the question is, where does it come from? And when you talk about Brexit, then the important thing to highlight is that it wasn't Farage. It was Cameron. It was a political failure of leadership, because 3.5 years ago, he linked his political career to this referendum promise. And the task of leading the country, he just passed that task on to the population. So it was a failure of leadership. So there is a lesson to be learned. You fail to take political leadership for whatever reasons, because of anxiety or whatever. And, of course, everybody was behind Europe, that Euro decision, for example, the East extension. Had you had a referendum on that in Germany with regards to East extension, that would have had a fatal result, such referendums. It was political leadership decisions which politicians stood by. And that's what currently is lacking, that people fight for their values with passion. And that is the topic of this panel. It's not that movement towards the right. Some do the wrong, the evil populism, and the others do the good populism. No, everything of that kind will promote populism. And you have to fight for your values. So just look at the Netherlands and Austria and Alexander van der Bellen. That was no soft populism. He counted on what people want, like Heimat, homeland. We had a hard time discussing that at the Green Party, but it is important for people. Do you have to talk about that more? And one last thought, the several level system in Europe. Europe is a several level system in all these levels. Ralf Fuchs quite rightly pointed that out. What's working, what's not working, you know, like childcare, a daycare institute. I'm a mother, and if you look at major elections on the municipal level, below 15% of people vote, and European Parliament election participation was more than 60%. So these various different levels in Europe, they have to work, they have to function, and the tasks they have been tasked with have to be fulfilled, and that you take responsibility for your political decision, which is very important. Barbara, what's your analysis? Why have we had a situation that in Poland have had anti-liberal forces gained a majority? Was that a political change, or is there a underlying societal crisis?
Well, I will try to be brief. They won because they were good enough to win, and the others were bad enough not to win. And I think this is a fair answer. It's not only about Poland. It's about all populists all over the world. Especially those going with far right-wing agenda, nationalistic agenda. They have a vision. The vision I'm completely disagreeing with. But at least there is a proposal. There is a concrete purpose. They are leading their countries. They are having a vision. They are trying to have a leadership, which unfortunately it's not a case of anti-populists. We are fighting against, first of all, the conservative or stagnated mainstream constantly. Those groups that want to Europe be as it is now, And we as progressives, we know that Europe needs reforms. We cannot pretend that everything is fine. Not everything is fine. Inequalities are deeper and deeper. There is no concrete answer towards crises we describe that were described beforehand. We can criticize European Union, but we want to, as progressives, what I would like to say, we need to change European Union. Mainstream says, conservative, social democrats, depends. Mainstream says, let's keep it as it is. And progressives are fighting two visions. Right-wing vision, destroy. Mainstream vision, keep it as it is. I think both are incorrect. Both are not bringing progress. Both are not bringing changes society needs. Do coming with our agenda, being loudly heard, it's sometimes very difficult because society wants to have a comfortable life, and sometimes even for society, it's better to think let's leave it as it is. Being reformist, but being for reforms that will bring more democracy, more equality, more transparency is quite a difficult task. And the weird thing is that we are waking up when sometimes it's too late, which also is casus of Poland. For us, for next 2 years, it's too late for any progressive agenda. We have to fight for the institutions. The institutions, actually, we didn't trust. Me as social democrat, me as progressive, I didn't trust in constitutional tribunal because they failed. They failed women equality issues. They failed social justice decisions and inequalities because institutions were freshly built but rotten from the beginning of this construction. And I think we can see some similarities with the European Union. We would love to support European Union, but first European Union need to reform its institutions. It will be very difficult to fight for more transparency if you see the leadership of European Union lacking transparency. It will be very difficult to fight for gender equality if you see from the top that there is nothing fighting for gender equality. Of course, there are money spent for this. But if you look at the leadership, sometimes it's missing, real leadership. What can be done? Because I think politicians should answer to all the questions, and this is their role. That's why they are paid for, to propose visions, propose actions. And if they are not strong enough to win, they should be not elected any longer. This is their task, to fight, to propose and solve the problems. So what can be done? We can see some positive changes in the societies. Because of globalization, we are better educated, more active, more motivated sometimes to act. And coming from Poland, where for 1.5 year we had many demonstrations against right-wing government, protesting, opposing nearly every action they did, we were successful only once. Once when we were fighting for stopping the abortion ban to be implemented. Why we were successful? Because that was the genuine, huge movement of society. Women in Poland and in many European countries, also here in Berlin, Poles and Germans were on the streets protesting against taking our rights back. Sometimes one would say it's not enough to protect rights, but at least this is an action. This is what we need as citizens of Europe, common actions for common values. But for have these common actions and common values, we need strong politicians that would be brave enough to say some things that are not very popular, that are able to be against mainstream, that will be able to criticize things they don't like in European Union and demand democratic changes inside. There is no purpose to saying that everything is great. There is a film called Hate of Matthew Kasavitz from the 90s. There is a very famous scene when man falls down from the roof and repeats constantly, so far, so good, so far, so good. No, In Poland, he's already down, but here, all over European countries, he's still falling. Don't keep repeating, so far, so good. Not good at the moment, but can be changed, contrary to film.
Ja, vielen Dank, Barbara.
Thank you, Barbara. Now, these have been two important messages for us. A, Europe needs to change, needs to be more democratic, needs justice, fairness, and transparency. And this is what we will discuss during our panel here. Credibility and believing in institutions. There are lots of people who have not believed in EU institutions so far, and yet this is the time to defend these institutions because they have brought democracy and stability for many years. Now, Mr. Preuß, let me ask you, why do we put Europe as a whole in question if in one country fundamental rights are being violated when the Constitutional Court is reduced in its capacity? Why does this mean a threat to Europe as a whole, and what would be your conclusion? Now, being a lawyer, I could go and say it's what the contracts say, it's what the conventions say, all member states have agreed on this particular approach. And of course, we know that this is also about defending social rights and others, but in the times of a crisis, this is not an adequate answer. And of course, we need to assume that people agree before they write sentences into a contract. A contract or a convention, an agreement, is a mutual promise. And making such a promise also tells us more about the relationship between the countries concerned, and we also need to look back at the history and look at the nation states of the past. And I mean, these were empires structured on the basis of a certain structures of dominance, and big countries like France, Germany, and of course the UK on the one hand, and on the other hand you have Cyprus and Malta, show that we are dealing with a heterogeneous system. But you always need a certain situation given in order to have an agreement work. And this is not about words only or writing down beautiful sentences. This is about living it. If the Constitutional Court in Poland is being cut, so to speak, or rights are taken away from people in other countries, we face a situation in which we must say that those countries have a different approach or interpretation of what we here consider the rule of law. So it's important to look at each other mutually and, if need be, correct each other without interpreting the correction as mingling with internal affairs. This is rather to be implemented on the basis of mutual recognition and support. Annalena, we agree to say that the violation of fundamental rights is not a national problem, but a European one, because of the legitimacy and the functioning of the EU, because attacking those rights in one country means an attack to the EU as a whole. The question is now, what is the European answer in case this happens? Mr. Preuß just said intervention. Mutual support, but intervention. Now, so far, there have only been rare cases, Poland, Hungary. In some countries, individual fundamental rights have been violated, whereas Hungary and Poland are characterized by fundamental transformations or modifications of the state. Now, in view of the new EU framework pertaining to the rule of law, the EU has tried to talk to Poland and Hungary too. But a dialogue needs to be based on trust, and what happens if a country does not agree to embark on a dialogue? So far, whatever has been done has proven inefficient. So what's to do? I mean, what can we do? What would be your answer? Well, we have to see things as they are, and you should not go and commit the mistake we did in the past time and again when talking about the enlargement. People said, okay, there is the acquis communicaire, and let's just check the box, and that's it. Now, today, people are trying to improve what has been agreed upon. The federal parliamentary group of the Green Party is also focusing on this topic, and this is not meant to be a situation in which politicians from another country go and tell another country again, you did well or you did not well. So when it comes to the fundamental rights in individual countries of the EU member states, we should have committees consisting of 10 experts of the national parliament and the European Parliament, so that we get monitoring reports about the situation in given countries, and these reports are to be discussed also in the Council and in all parliamentary bodies. Article 7 is one of the possibilities Parliament has, but it can be used. Romania is a good example. Thousands of young people go to the streets, and the moral support they get from other countries is key, because here we can generate or lose trust with respect to Europe. If something needs to be done and nothing happens, it will lead to a loss of trust. Let's have a look at the anti-corruption initiative in Romania, for example. They tried hard to do something about corruption, and if thousands are in the streets, they are much louder and much more efficient and visible than a press release sent from Brussels. So there are examples we can consider, but it's always important to also consider the cultural context. And we should not only focus on fundamental rights. And I wonder what Barbara tells us. We had a representative in our parliamentary group for 13 years, and when talking about Germany and Poland, he tended to say, well, don't have too much intervention from the outside. Let's talk about it, but it should be an internal affair. So the question is, what about support? What kind of support is welcome? Demonstrations, protest marches, right? But what about the division of power? What is the best division of labor? What's the best to do? We know from other countries where there are clear demands made at our address. From Poland, I hear that people don't want us to be too aggressive or militant. Now, that's about the question, what helps, what causes damage?
First of all, you should face one thing. Government of Jarosław Kaczyński disliked Germany. This is true. Whatever you would do, he would criticize it. If you would be silent, he would criticize that you are silent, but in the conspiracy there is something going on. If you would say something loudly, he would criticize that you say it loudly. So let's make it clear. Whatever you would do, either you would interfere, no, react or not, you will be under his critics. It's the same with opposition in Poland. We can do nothing, but we are doing a lot of things, but we can do nothing, and he will be constantly attacking opposition, naming also the leaders. So don't bother. Don't bother. Do things that you think will be helpful to those you are cooperating with. What was helpful for women's movement? International support of women from all the world. What happens, civil movements that are to demonstrate next Saturday for Europe? Demonstrations with support of Poland, people coming to Poland, showing their solidarity. What will help our pride that will be held in June? Presence of people from abroad saying we share your values. It's not the fact that Poland is divided 2-2. Half of society is far right, radical. No, not even all supporters of law and justice are like this. They sometimes supported law and justice because they knew Poland needed changes, and they thought law and justice will deliver necessary changes. They delivered changes, absolutely not necessary changes, because what they're doing is that they are taking the institutions and they are destroying them, and they are putting their own people that are completely unprepared for those institutions to lead the institutions and destroy them from internal, but benefiting a lot out of being in charge of the institutions. And people will get rid of it. I'm not sure if they will get rid of it in 3 years. Maybe it will take some more time, but society will be angry also because they will not improve the situation. Now they are improving a little bit situation of most poor and excluded with distribution project called 500 plus. So every second kid in family gets 120 euros, which is a good program because it helps people. Simply gives them more money to pay their debts. It's absolutely conservative concept the way they are distributing this, but at the moment they are popular. But it's not only about this. It's also about the access to labor market, which won't be better. It's also access to decent jobs. It's also improving the quality of jobs. It's also bringing the investors to Poland, and they are not able to do this. So in a few years' time, they will be over, not because of constitutional tribunal, but because of economy. This is one thing that we should remember. But the others, those who are in favor of European Union equality, justice, solidarity, cannot feel abandoned. Because if we would feel abandoned, if we would have a feeling that Europe doesn't need us any longer, why should we fight that strongly? We had a dream in 2003 of joining European Union when we had referendum in Poland, queuing for many hours after all in front of embassies. Well, we used to queue in the 80s, so we were queuing by habit. But we voted to our dream become true, dream about solidarity, about social justice, dream about more equality and our safety. What we have now, we are facing the fact that we are more secure for sure, We don't have more social justice because our conservative government, previous ones, were never interested in implementing Charter of Social Rights. We don't have as much as equality as we would, as we should have. Poland is only one, well, it's one of the few countries that have ban on abortion, because European Union was never strong enough to make Poland change these laws. Although Tribunal in Strasbourg already said that we should, but there was no mechanism for pressure, of pressure to Poland. So asking what to do, help us, simply help our civil society to feel strong, to feel necessary, to feel important, to feel welcome. Majority of Poles are pro-European. We do feel citizens of Europe. How concretely? Very deeply we feel since I was...
How to help concretely?
Concretely? I just said, participating in our events, demonstrations, helping civil society to organize. Polish-German cooperation was one of the very strongest and most successful ones. A lot of prejudices were gone. Kaczyński was not ever influenced by those projects, which probably is a problem, and that's why he's so anti-German. But those, especially young people who were part of student exchange, pupil exchange, who came here to work, felt okay, not all of them, but majority of them felt okay, felt with dignity. And how European Union can help us concretely? Reform itself, not to make Europe that easy target to criticize. If Europe would operate strongly and concretely and change the laws, that would have any mechanisms. What kind of mechanism European Union has at the moment, apart of sending Venice Commission or saying that they would trigger the Article 7? Not that much, really. So maybe this would need a bigger reform inside the European Union. And we will try, as a civil society, to make sure that this recent decision will be done with us being present, not having a proper representation with the government, but as a civil society, we will do our job. Just try to remember that the government of countries does not always represent citizens or even majority of citizens. That will be enough.
Okay. Vielen Dank. Herr Preuß,
Mr. Preuß, before talking about social commitment, I would like to come back to the question of sanctions. Barbara said there are no sanctions. Are there more sanctions feasible within the EU in order to do something about violations of fundamental rights in EU member states? Article 7 has been mentioned by Mrs. Baerbock already. This is, so to speak, the utmost sanction, i.e. a unanimous vote in the European Council, according to which the EU is to withdraw the right to vote from the country. Now, since there are 28 member states, it's going to be difficult to implement this rule, because in the case of one sinner, you won't find others who agreed to Article 7 apply to the sinner, because every country is a sinner now and then. So it might be a way to talk about majority rule here, i.e. to adopt these sanctions also by majority rule, not only on the basis of a unanimous decision. Or an exclusion could also be a potential sanction. We could also talk about exclusions. I mean, the EU is a voluntary league of peoples, I'd like to say. I don't want to say it's a league of nations, but it's a league of peoples. Thus, it's a bit difficult to exclude countries from their membership, since the whole thing is voluntary. But you can strategically cut the right to vote. But then, of course, this is also against the community. It doesn't correspond to the purpose and the sense and the culture of the EU, which wants to be an association of peoples, i.e. to withdraw the right to vote is not the right way to go either. We'll have to find ways and means to implement sanctions if need be. But Article 7, without a unanimous vote in the European Council, would be a beginning, maybe a two-third majority in order to protect the community. If there are individual exceptions, Article 7 governs the rights of the voting rights of the EU member states in the European Council, and so the European Council, the Council of the heads of state and of government, decides about Article 7 and its application, but it applies, of course, also to the European Council. That's the way to put it correctly. But financial sanctions are usually much more efficient because financial sanctions hurt. You cut certain budgets and this triggers the resentment or the angriness of the people. Because, I mean, there are countries like Poland or Hungary where people or governments like to criticize the EU, and yet they happily agree to accept the funding offered by the EU. So the whole architecture, the whole balance is fragile, and I think we can better the system here, clearly. I don't want to be to say too much right now, but since we are celebrating the 60th anniversary of the EU, I'd like to remind you of the fact that the EU architecture as such is a good one, including the ever closer union, which was the idea adopted already at day one. But in view of the diversity of countries and cultures, people have forgotten this particular dimension, and we are much more focusing on subsidiarity, but maybe we should focus on diversity more. Yeah, maybe, but I'd like to go another way. Barbara said that there is one good thing concerning the political situation in Poland, i.e. there is much more social commitment, and there are many more militant people who agree to get involved and fight. And there is a representative of an initiative here with us on the panel, an initiative that said Europe is going down, the values are being threatened, but we don't want to just be shocked, we want to act. And that's why we are very happy to have you here with us. Points of Europe is just one example of initiatives that decided to do something for the benefit of Europe. So let me ask you, please, what was your reason and what do you do in order to pursue your goals, Mr. Knigge?
Impuls war ehrlich gesagt ein fataler Anruf eines Studiums.
Well, the impulse was a call from a friend when I had my studies, and that cost me a lot of time after that. Positive Europe was happening for the first time then, conceived by a circle of friends over a glass of beer in the evening. And that brings us to the impulse. Reaction to Brexit. We were about to digest the election of Donald Trump, where we then thought, well, the impossible is possible, and the France election, the third step towards the doom of Europe. So demonstrating afterwards is wrong, is too late. One day after the inauguration of Donald Trump, I mean, one day after the inauguration, hundreds of thousands of people took to the street. Too late. So we have to act up earlier. So I had a very cozy and pleasant and comfortable life before I started this initiative, and have never registered a demonstration. I have to think when did I last attend a demonstration? I couldn't recall. So I was satisfied with just about everything. I was always pleased with not taking to the street, but then we took to the street. Of course, we had that experience from Frankfurt, where it first started, where it was just a circle of friends, word of mouth, you know. And the first time, 200 people convened. Now here I see the pictures. That's from the Berlin demonstration. I don't know how much do I need to share with you here. This morning we heard that the journalists cover bad news and that love to cover bad news because Europe is so boring and little positive things are covered. And listen, they are attacking us. They are, you know, hunting us down. They want info from us, you know, the press. So, and you meet every Sunday 14 hours in various different cities in Germany and across Europe. Yes, what started in France, I lost my train of thought, sorry, and that spilled over into big cities, small cities, and we're now in the meantime in 9 member states and in 60 cities. Berlin, of course, is the biggest of those, but they all over the place you have these demonstrations. And in Frankfurt, we always have the competition who has more demonstrators on the streets. And in the meantime, the Berliners take the lead over Frankfurt. Oh, at the Gendarmenmarkt in Berlin, yes, square. 14 hours, we meet at the Gendarmenmarkt, the Gendarmenmarkt square in Berlin. Maybe I explain what happens there. There is just people meeting, and as people meet one another, that usually go to take to the streets, they tell one another what they think of Europe and what they like about Europe. And that a friend of studies to me, then I mentioned it earlier, said, this is so emotional that you go demonstrate and make an emotional display of Europe. And that's the trick. Everybody who attended this will approve of what I'm saying. For the first time, people explain their feelings over Europe, and which is not done normally, which was only touched upon briefly today. It's a feeling of life for the youngest and also for the older populations, because they recall that this is a peace alliance and that it brought prosperity. That is maybe something which is a driving factor for the older generations, and for the youngest, it's the lifestyle. It's like, you know, moving, and but for the elder, it's like prosperity and peace. So we have an open mic. Everybody can take to the street and to the stage and say something. I've got a coarse road, and yesterday it was raining like cats and dogs, and I don't know how many people were below an umbrella, but the estimates say it was at least 3,000 people. Maybe it was more. And that was when it was raining cats and dogs. And that is 2 weeks ago. There was nice weather. We were more than 5,000 then. And then very emotional things happen. We are at the staircase of the concert hall. And the concert hall likes us. They help us. Dora Feitmann was on the stair, and obviously a singer, an opera singer, and performed the hymn of Europe. And then the people started singing, and Dora Feitmann played the tune, and thousands of people chanting hymn of Europe. That was very beautiful. Very emotional contributions over the mic. This is a 10-year-old boy who prepared out for the speech, but he really did that. He stood up in front of thousands of people, took the mic, and says, look, my granddad is from Russia, the other one is from Italy, the parents from one of them came from Finland, my mother comes from East Germany, my father is from West Germany, and my favorite soccer club is from Italy, and so wonderful. Very emotional, nice performance here and thing. And when I hear all these things, these thoughts about Europe, which are very theoretical sometimes, but look, it's not so difficult to talk about the parts of Europe emotionally. I cannot even give you a position of parts of Europe. There is none. There is no a charter or something. It's just a wild bunch of people joining. In the Berlin organization team, there's all party political parties represented except AfD, from the Linke right down to the Christian Democrats, everybody. And we all really happy. We all agree under these blue flags and go along well and respect one another and listen to one another. But the foundation is all, we share the same foundation, so that's really great. Maybe I'll tell more about this in a minute.
Could you join us on Saturday 25th in Warsaw in a big march? We ask for concrete things, so this is a concrete thing.
Also, das geht nicht, weil wir hier in Berlin am 25.
It's not possible because we will be marching on the 25th in Berlin. We joined the March of Europe appeal and do a march in Berlin. I was sharing with you that this is 9 states, 60 cities. We every week we get 20 to 30 inquiries of new cities, so it is growing at a fast pace, and this is good so. And unfortunately, Poland is not on board, even though we talk to many, many, many Polish friends. So we hope that maybe next week or in 2 weeks' time that Pulse of Europe will also be happening in Wrocław, in Warsaw, and what have you. So we talk to the Polish friends, and please come to the Pulse of Europe meeting there. Sunday. We can do both, Saturday and Sunday. Thank you. That is one example of an initiative. There's many more. Now, we are at, on a different level again. Now, you had this emotional level that you addressed. But the principal thing, you know, we thought that the achievements of Europe, or for which Europe gave a promise, freedom, peace, prosperity for all, we thought we always have that. And now we are confronted with the fact that this may not be the case, that it is not a matter of course, that everybody has to do something for that, also the younger generation, that these achievements stay. That's the future. The future, above all, for the younger generations. Annalena, before I pass the floor on to you here, I would like to collect a couple of statements from the floor. I think this is a good moment. But this guy, he wants to present another initiative. But first the lady here, where is he? Where is she?
Say that it's very interesting to listen to all these
talk, but I want to do, if possible, a very little comment and then a question. I think that all the speakers were talking about liberal and anti-liberal, but we are still missing an important point, that is to characterize what liberal policies actually meant for Europe. So I haven't listened any list of policies that, according to us, were wrong. So I just want to say cite some of them, because I think it's useful for the discussion, and also because I come from a southern country, so maybe it's interesting, from Italy, so maybe it's interesting to have this. I think that one policy that was addressed and was really enforced by European Union was labor market deregulation, and we have seen, for instance, in France, there has been now the loi travail, and we have seen which have been the consequences of this kind of policies, which with increasing fragmentation, with fragility, with inequalities, with working poor, temporary work, and a lot of part-time jobs that were made instead of full-time jobs. So this, is for me, the something that we should stress. Another kind of policies is the idea of a free capital, free mobility of capital, and we know that many monetary institutions have stressed this point as one of the factors that increased fragility across European countries. If you see the exposure, for instance, of German banks before the crisis in southern banks. Then another point is fiscal policies and tax regressive policies that have increased inequalities, as, for instance, Piketty stressed. And finally, the lack of mission-oriented policies, because in Europe we speak a lot about innovation, but we don't speak about mission-oriented policies, and I think that this is a problem. For instance, Professor Mazzucato says that this is one road that we should pursue instead of just giving investment to firms. And here is the question: which are, according to you, the most important policies that we can and we should do at European European level? And if it is possible to do this, because I think that this can help us to take working class, young people from the populist movement to us.
Vielen Dank. Wir sammeln etwas zu dieser Herr.
Let's compile a couple of more questions here. My name is Vasco Esteves. I'm from Portugal. I represent Diem 25. If you happen to not know what that is an initiative for democratization of Europe. Because our objective is that until 2025 there is democratization of Europe. This movement a year ago exactly was founded by Yanis Varoufakis, a former finance minister of Greece, who has made a lot of traumatic experience with the European institutions and with the Eurogroup, etc. Sorry, this was off the mic. And with the help of others, Noam Chomsky or Julian Assange and other prominent figures. But our movement is not a celebrity movement. It's not a party. It is a movement. And our objective is to push for European democratization. To explain, we want to join forces against the populist right-wing extremists and prevent them from taking power. This is good, but it is not sufficient, because the root causes for right-wing populist movements to gather force have not been removed. So we believe that the European institutions are not under popular control. They are not genuinely democratic. To give you an example, the Eurogroup, which is constituted, but you don't find a charter. There is no these meetings are not public. So you need a control for such a institution in inverted commas. And European Parliament has not sufficient power to control what European politicians are doing, and many, many more examples. So let's give others an opportunity also to present their views. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Ich kann noch von hinten jemanden nehmen.
Any more requests for the floor? There are some people in the back of the room.
Thank you. Near to my own of working for Ecologic. I have a question for Barbara. You were saying that anti-liberal governments or movements actually were strong enough or good enough to win the elections in Poland. And that was partly because they have a vision. So my question is, I mean, what is a vision for progressive to win elections?
So, jetzt noch eine letzte, ja, ganz hinten, der Herr.
Danke, danke schön. Ich komme auch aus Polen. Ich möchte herzlich bitten.
I'm also from Poland, and I would like to thank you, Mrs. Nowacka, for being so enthusiastic about our government. I'd like to ask a question to the organizers, however. Wouldn't it be good to have a representative of the populist parties here too? Because then we can talk with them about their ideas. So I'd like to ask you to also invite those people from Poland.
Abschlussrunde. Es waren ja zwei Fragen.
Concluding round on this panel. There were two questions. Fundamentally, one more or less focused on the social dimension, the other focusing on the legal and democratic function. So maybe Annalena, you can could you come back to the aspect of democratic control? Earlier today, we heard that for many people, it's about regaining or recovering political control or democratic control. So maybe, Barbara, you start and give us an answer to all those questions, these questions.
Question, Madam Pütz, is actually answering the question Mr. Was kind to ask, what kind of policies European Union should make progressive vision. And first of all, labor market. Without concrete proposals, how to ensure that people will have jobs and chance to have a decent life? Concrete proposals, including concrete policies. We will not be able to win. What is missing at the moment in the world of progressive is a hope. Hope for better life, better living, chances for having not only the career, just a regular, decent life. Younger generation is disturbed by fact that they have no future. If they don't have any future, no promises, what will happen with them in the labor market? They are frustrated. They are seeking the answers in the nationalisms. They are seeking answers in xenophobia. They are seeking answers in the closeness. So asking about policies, first policy, employment, especially concerning youth and youth employment. Adding to that, facing problems with automatization and robotization, because this is a topic that is debated both on very elitist level, but also for workers, people knowing that their jobs, their sense of life to some extent might be over. And secondly, coming to that, is social policies. Europe is rich. Europe is rich enough to ensure that its citizens are decently have decent wages, that they don't need to have three jobs to afford the cost of living, that they have enough money to have a flat to live with and have enough money to send their kids to schools, schools that would give them future. So the answer for division should be labor market and social policies that would give us what we really want to have and what actually European Union gave us for 60 years, peace and prosperity. If our goal is to have a peace and prosperity, we won't have it without chances for good living. Good living means good jobs. Far right, I think sometimes they don't want to have peace and progress. They are against those values that are constituting us. And we can also go to the details, what kind of policies concerning environment, concerning relations with trade unions, concerning democracy, concerning economy, concerning fiscal policies should be implemented. But first of all, I think, and for me this is something extremely important, to say that we would fight for equality for all in all aspects, including labor market, not including companies and their benefits. Europe should be for its citizens, not for not its capital.
Danke schön. Ja, Herr Preuß, nein, okay. Dann Annalena Baerbock.
Da sind wir, glaube ich, schon bei dem größten Dilemma.
Well, that's most probably the biggest dilemma the EU faces, because the EU wants to create social justice, which implies fair taxation. However, on the European scale, on the European level, there's not much that can be done. And this is certainly one of the promises made to the newcomers, to the new kids on the block. Prosperity was promised, different funds were established, the social one, the regional one. But the question, where does it come from, was never answered. And the social glue, so to speak, that keeps things together is still what we find in the countries. And that's why many mainstream politicians say, well, we are not really in it, and there is not really anything in it for us. So if we don't solve the social problem, we'll have problems, because either the nation states are willing to give away competences to the or responsibilities to the European level. For example, the health insurance, a European unemployment insurance has been discussed even within the Green Party with many different views. But when we talked about Greece, and then someone said, well, imagine a European unemployment insurance would mean we have to give 20% of the benefits to Southern Europe. I don't know whether this is true or not, but of course we have to talk about it. However, if these problems are to be furthermore solved on the national level, unemployment and others, we'll have to deal with the results at elections. We all know what insurance systems we have in our countries and what current trends are. You might remember 2004 to 2006, the service directive, which was discussed on the European level with the aspect of free movement and free capital. And there too, people said even services to help people survive, so to speak, should be privatized. But here, majority decisions were taken on the European level, and now many things which are not running well in the countries are being blamed on the EU. Taxation, well, that's maybe different taxations for capital in Europe. That's a problem where it would be easier to have Europe in charge, but there you need the unanimous decision in the council, and that's a bit difficult to get, at least at times. And of course, we need to be careful not to make any more false promises, because there is the tool of strengthened and reinforced collaboration. Remember, 3 years ago, we talked about the Tobin tax, and there were 7 countries who said, well, let's go and introduce the Tobin tax. We'll start off, the others follow. Nothing has ever happened here. Or the additional taxation of revenue generated by stocks. That's what the Tobin tax was about. You pay an extra tax for revenue generated by stock speculation or investment. And as I said, nothing has happened in spite of the fact that 7 countries said, it's a good idea, let's do it. So I would like to warn against false promises and against hoping that things can happen quickly. They cannot. And at the end of the day, quite often on the European level, we need to double check which party, which political party represents what idea, because the majority situation also in the council is a given one, and there are many conservative parties involved here and there when it comes to social regulations, the minimum income directive, for example, unemployment benefits and other aspects are being discussed under the premises of right-wing or conservative parties. The question is, do we get the majorities we need in order to implement better programs? Mr. Preuß, concluding remarks. Democratic control, that's one of the questions raised. It's difficult to really figure out what is meant by democratic control. Is it the nation state? In Hungary or Poland, they'd probably say democratic control is the control exercised by the nation state, no matter what national agenda you pursue. Or is it the democratic legitimation of European programs and procedures? Now, this is the aspect I mentioned a while ago when I said, let's look back at what the situation was 40, 50, or 60 years ago. 60 years ago, when the EU was founded, there was a different concept of democracy at the time. This is an old-fashioned distinction, but it's roughly true. It was about the state nation and the cultural nation at the time. And the former one is about territorialities and different ethnic minorities and shifting boundaries in Central and Eastern Europe. And there, the idea of a nation is completely different from what we have here. So nation there is not necessarily connected with a state. It's about ethnic groups, peoples. And this means a completely different approach also with respect to the duty to accept a certain number of migrants in a given country, because they go and say they destroy our nation because the nation is the people, whereas in other countries people go and say this is crude ethno-nationalism and that's it. So we need to be aware of the fact that Europe is heterogeneous, that it's diverse, and that there are major cultural differences. So we need to bear in mind that the one-size-fits-all solution does not always work in Europe, yet we need to find one. However, considering what the peoples concerned think of their nation and democracy and what for them is a nation and democracy. And another aspect which is connected, I'd say. Ten years after the treaties of Rome were adopted, there was a kind of coup, a constitutional coup, so to speak, by the European Court of Justice. I mean, the lawyers here know what I'm talking about. It was Geneva Laws and Costa Adel. Now, the court ruled these treaties are, so to speak, European constitutions, and they have an impact at every level for each and every citizen, meaning that there is no filter anymore. A European decision is automatically to be implemented in the context of a national legal order, or is automatically to become national jurisdiction, which is due to the fact that the court is what is now being called a jurisdocracy, i.e. the rule of the courts, which is another constructive problem, I'd say, with respect to the EU, because European nations have called in legal institutions which are actually not the responsible institutions. This goes for the European Court of Justice, but also for the ECB, for example. It makes sense in a certain setting, true, but it removes democratic legitimacy from the state, which is actually responsible, irrespective of what we might discuss in the field of social policy, labor market policy, help for Greece, and so on. And a lot what I'm seeing there is a major disaster. But I'm not talking about the implementation of these policies. I'm talking about the constitutional basis of the EU. And here, the European Union and all those who strive for it should be very sensitive and should listen closely in order to not miss those new question. Anti-liberal movements are posing those questions, but they are not being answered. 30 years ago, someone said, fascism gives the mob its expression, but it doesn't give it the right. And the same goes for the anti-liberal movements today. So we are dealing with facts, hard facts. Thank you very much once again. The panel has shown that we need to talk about hardware and software, because institutions are getting especially important when they might disappear or when there is a threat and they might be deconstructed. But that's also the time at which we need to look at political questions, and social injustice is a topic which is being mentioned here time and again, but also the gap between your expectations and the possibilities of Europe. However, I liked the initiative, the movement you have introduced, Mr. Knigge, the emotional dimension, the values which are being underlined by such an initiative. People are willing, are eager to fight for these values at an early stage, not when it's too late. That is, voting too is an option. Participating in elections, civil courage is also an option. Fight for Europe, that's the appeal. Thank you very much. There is going to be another break now. And please be back in half an hour.